Morning. Welcome to Highland. We are so glad that you are here. If this is your first time joining us, we want to extend a special welcome to you. And you could have been anywhere this morning. All of us could have been anywhere this morning, but we're so grateful to be together in God's presence, listening to God's word, singing his praises. And we thank you that you have joined us this morning. I wanted to, the only major ministry announcement that we have this morning is we wanted to start, as we always want to start, we just want to brag on God. God has again just generously provided through your offerings to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, which goes to help plant churches in North America. North America is one of the primary mission areas in the world now. In fact, other countries are now sending missionaries to North America to help reach the lost here. And so this money that you have given helps to go do that. It helps fund church planters and the work in which they do. We had a goal set at $25,000, which was a lofty goal, but through your generous gifts and through God's movement in that, we were able to collect $38,522.88. So let's give God praise this morning. And I do want you to know, I don't tell you that so that we can lean over and pat one another on each other's backs. It's not about us. It is about that God's people are always generous people because that's what we've received from God. He didn't hold anything back when he gave us his son in Jesus, right? And so we don't want to hold anything back as well. So thank you for supporting missions in North America. And so let's turn our attention to God's word. And I want to read from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, as we set our heart's affection on the Lord and our mind's attention on him, because like I just said, we're here to celebrate him and what he has done through his son Jesus and that we get to benefit from. Peter says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his possession." And here's why. "So that you may proclaim the praises of the one who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." If you have followed Jesus, put your faith in him as Lord, we are gathered together to celebrate what Jesus has done in us. He has taken us from death to life, from darkness to his kingdom of light. And that's why we're here, is to celebrate him. Amen? Amen. Let me pray, and then we're going to continue to worship him through song and through scripture reading and also through the message this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have called us out of darkness and into light, into your marvelous light. Lord, there is nothing in us that made you want to save us, that made you want to turn and rescue us. Lord, it is only out of what you have done in your heart, because you are love and you are grace and you are mercy, that we sit here this morning, saved, being sanctified, one day will be glorified, not in our flesh, not in our work, but in the work of the finished work of Jesus Christ. We praise you for him. We praise him this morning. We praise you through the power of the Spirit this morning. Lord, would you inhabit our praises? Would you motivate our worship, that our eyes would be fixed on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, that you would capture our heart's affection, that our mind's attention will be focused solely on the work and the person of Jesus. We want him to take center stage this morning. We want all of this to be pointed to him this morning and what you have accomplished in him. May you receive all glory, honor, and praise, God, for what you are doing and what you have already accomplished. We give you this whole time in worship devoted to you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Would you stand as we kick off worship and sing "The Solid Rock"?
Jesus,
power, the glory, and the majesty, and the splendor, for everything in heaven and everything on earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over everything. Wealth and honor alone come from you, for you are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give thanks and we praise your glorious name together. Would you sing with us this morning?
The sun comes out, it's a new
Bless the Lord.
that you will do greater things. It's my time to go, but before I leave, go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go now for a little while, but goodbye is not the end. Don't forget the things that I've taught you. I've conquered death and I hold the key. Where I go, you will go to someday. But there's much to do here before you leave. So go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've gotta go.
What do you think it takes for you to get to heaven and have eternal life? When's the last time you thought about how to answer that question? In your opinion, what does it take for you to get to heaven, have eternal life? Maybe your answer will be like a lot of people's. When I ask people that question, normally the answers, they range, but they're kind of common, and so maybe you find yourself answering something like this. Well, I'm hoping that, you know, my good deeds will outweigh my bad deeds in the end. Or I try to be a good person. Or I try to treat my family well. I try to work hard. I'm sincere at living life. I'm thankful, you know, for the things that I have in my life. Maybe that's how you answer. Maybe it's, I try to use my money in good, positive ways. How would you answer the question, in your opinion, what does it take for you to get to heaven and have eternal life? People have opinions on everything, especially this question. But what does God have to say about that? What does God have to say about how he would answer that question? That's an important question. And thankfully, in the book of Matthew, Matthew records a story of Jesus answering that very question. What does it take for you to get to heaven and have eternal life? So here's the story of the rich young ruler as Matthew records it. So someone came to Jesus and asked him, "Teacher, what good thing must I do to have eternal life?" And Jesus asked him, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There's only one who is good. If you want eternal life, Then keep the commandments. The young man asks, which ones? Side note, probably a good question when there's 613, not just the 10. And so Jesus says, well, do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Basically, love your neighbor as yourself. And the young man says, well, I've kept all of those since the time of my youth. But what am I still lacking? And Jesus says, well, if you want to be perfect, if you want to have eternal life, then go and sell everything you have. Give it to the poor. You'll have treasure in heaven. And then come follow me. And Matthew says, the young man turned and he left Jesus grieving because he had many possessions. So Jesus turns to his disciples and says, truly I tell you, it is hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. To which his disciples were utterly astonished and they said, well, who then can be saved? And Jesus, listen in. This is what Jesus says. He looks at them and he says, with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. How would Jesus answer? How did he answer this question? In your opinion, what does it take for you to get to heaven and have eternal life? That's what we want to deal with today. We start a brand new series this morning called The Six Hard Sayings of Jesus. There is many more than six. Jesus said a lot of difficult things to understand, a lot of things that are easy to understand, but difficult following. This is that one. It is easy to understand what Jesus is saying. The difficulty, the hard thing about it is what he's requiring of us to follow him. Six hard sayings of Jesus. If you and I are going to go to heaven, have salvation, have eternal life, here's what Jesus says to you. It's on the screen there. It's Jesus or nothing. It's Jesus or nothing. There is no middle ground with Jesus. He doesn't share. He's not okay with all of these other things in our life. It is Jesus or nothing. And I want to show you two truths that Jesus points out in this story, or Matthew, the reason why Matthew inserts this story into his gospel. Now, when we're reading narratives, stories, you know, that's a particular literature genre of the New Testament writers, I mean, Old Testament too. But narratives often have one meaning. They really are there to teach us one point. Now, we can infer other implications maybe from it, but the narrative is put there for one point. And the great narratives, I mean, they're all great, but the ones that are really, really just out there, just right in front of our face, are where Jesus explains what the point is. We don't have to worry about it. We have to figure out, what does he mean here? He tells us what the point is. And so here's truth number one. And I want you to go to Matthew 19, verses 23, and that's where we're going to be in the first truth that Jesus teaches us. It is, eternal life is impossible if it were up to you and me. Eternal life is impossible if it were up to us, to you and me. Look at verse 23. This is what he says. He says to his disciples, truly I tell you, it will be hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And when the disciples heard this, they were utterly astonished and asked, then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man, this is impossible. With man, this is impossible. Impossible in the Greek means impossible in English. It cannot happen. It is utterly futile to try to inherit, to try to earn salvation, eternal life on our own. God says it is not just wasteful, it's impossible. You and I can't do it. And the story only shows that. So let's walk back through this narrative of this rich young ruler. And we see that. First that we see here is when Jesus talks about the camel and the eye of a needle, you need to understand that this is the impossibility that he's talking about. He's not talking about some, I mean, there is no archaeological evidence of a door in Jerusalem that was called the eye of a needle that a camel would have to stoop through. They would take another route. That's as simple as that. Or they would wait until the day until they open the gate. It's fine. There's no archaeological evidence for that. So it's not that about this door in Jerusalem that was called the eye of a needle. It's also not the two Greek words for cable and for camel are similar, but the idea that this was a rope being passed through the eye of a needle, that's also false because that didn't come about until a few hundred years later. The idea here that Jesus is giving is he's just using hyperbolic language. He's trying to take a camel, which is the largest land animal in Palestine, and he's using it to say, to take the smallest aperture of his day, the eye of a needle, and he's saying that if you can get this big camel, through the eye of a needle, then sure, you can do eternal life on your own. Well, that's not going to be possible. We can't take a camel and put it through the eye of a little bitty needle. That is utterly impossible. And so Jesus is saying it's impossible. And then listen to the story of how this unfolds through this young man. Because before, we know he's a rich young man. We know he's, you know, a ruler. And sometimes when we come to this text, we think, well, Jesus isn't speaking to me because I'm not rich. We kind of compare ourselves to other people that are maybe more wealthy than we are. Well, he's not talking to me, so I don't really know what he's saying here. He's talking to all of us, and here's why. Who was this guy, the rich young ruler? By the way, Luke calls him a ruler. Matthew calls him young, so we put those together, the rich young ruler. What we see in the story here is that he was a person of social status. I mean, we see that. He's a young guy. He comes to Jesus, and Luke kind of uses this language of ruler. And so this guy has social status in the community. He's most likely 20 to 40 years old, somewhere around there. He's most likely a local synagogue leader. I mean, he's a respected guy in the community. Very few commentators would say that he's trying to trap Jesus in some sort of a ploy here, that he's just genuinely coming to Jesus and wanting to know, hey, how do I have eternal life? How do I get to heaven, Jesus? And so he was a respected guy of the community. He had social status. He also had wealth. He talks about he had many possessions. By the way, most commentators, they don't think that he was like a king. Being a ruler of the synagogue meant that, yes, he was wealthy, but he was in what would be considered of that day the middle class. That would be most of us. Most people in Meridian are in the middle class. So we have some connection with this guy. Most of us in here want to be respected leaders in the community or in our schools. We don't want to do anything that would deter our reputation. So he had social status, he had wealth, but more than that, he had upstanding morality. He was a good guy. How do we know? Well, Jesus gives him a test. If you want to know how to have eternal life, then keep the commandments. Okay, which ones? I want to do that. I want to see where I am. And so he gives him the second half, most of the second half of the Ten Commandments. He says, you know, do not murder. Okay, I didn't do that. Check that off the box. Do not commit adultery. Haven't done that. Check that off the box. Do not steal. Haven't done that. Check that off the box. Don't bear false witness. Don't lie. Check that off the box. Jesus basically says, hey, basically love your neighbor as yourself. Check. Done. But what else do I lack? Jesus gave him the test that is the easy one to see. It's the ones that we can see one another, how we do at that. It's observable. So what does Jesus do? He goes to the heart of the matter, right? And we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But he goes to the heart of the matter. But this guy, he was respected by the community. He was a wealthy man. He was a moral man. This sets the stage for why the disciples ask, who can be saved if this guy can't do it? See, what Matthew is doing and what this guy represents, he's a real guy, by the way, but what Matthew is doing, he's highlighting somebody that is respected in the community, has been blessed by God to have many possessions, and he's following God as best he can. He's a moral person. If anybody can be saved, it's a well-respected church leader who has been blessed by God and who lives that out. Surely that guy can be saved. He's the poster child for it. See, the things work today just like they did back then. When we see somebody who is well-respected, who God has obviously blessed with monetary, you know, and possession, money and possessions and stuff like that, and they're a moral person, we automatically look to that person like, man, that guy must follow Jesus. He's got to be saved. Look at him. He's got to be. And when Jesus says what he says about the camel and the eye of a needle, that it's impossible, that's why the disciples say, well, who in the world can be saved? If this guy can't be saved, I have no chance. You have no chance. Why couldn't he be saved? That's the question here. It's the way in which he viewed salvation. And this is the part you've got to listen to. If you've checked out, check back in. Don't miss this. It's the way he viewed salvation that kept him from eternal life. Let me illustrate it and then I'll explain it. Do you know what the... Do you know how many credit card transactions there are per year in the world? Other than some of you that I've already told this to, don't answer out loud. Any idea how many credit card transactions there are in the world per year? It's not in the thousands. It's not in the tens of thousands. I mean, some of y'all would see that on Amazon right now. But that's not even that, right? It's not even in the millions. It's barely in the billions. 678 billion transactions in 2022 of just credit card. That's not bank accounts, cash transactions, any of that. But listen to this, how this breaks down. That's 1.86 billion per day, 77.4 million per hour, 1.29 million per minute, 21,510 credit card transactions per second. The average American makes 210 credit card transactions per year, or one transaction every 1.75 days. That's a lot of transactions. So what's the point? The point is we live and exist in a world of transactions. It is normal. We live our life based on transactions. I give you this money, you give me this in return. I give you this kind of respect, you give me respect in return. I love you this way, I expect to be loved this way. If I do this, then you do that. We live and exist in a world of transactions. That may be okay on the human level, but that does not work with God. He is not a God of transactions. This gentleman who comes to Jesus knew about transactions. They were all about his life. He went to the temple and the synagogue. He kept these commandments and he expected this in return. He gave this portion of money to the temple or to the local synagogue. He expected this in return. But when he comes to Jesus and he says, "What must I do? What other thing can I do? What other transaction can I make so that I can get from you?" Jesus says, "I'm not about transactions. You can't do that. If you want a transaction, then go and sell everything you have and then come follow me." The guy went away, not sad. That's a very, very minimal view of that word. He went away grieving because he understood exactly what Jesus was getting at. "If you're going to follow me," Jesus says, "there can be nothing standing in the way. It's impossible," he says. We live in this transactional world. And the rich young ruler, he says, if I follow God's law, God gives me eternal life. He wanted to know what else to do. And yet you may be sitting right here this morning or watching online, and you may have the same view of salvation, this transactional view that if I said a prayer at some time, God must save me. If I give my money, then God saves me, or I have eternal life. Or if I'm a part of a Sunday school for 50 years, then I'm saved. Or if I come to church, then I'm saved. If I read my Bible, then I'm saved. That is a transactional view of salvation. And most likely, you're like the rich young ruler. You're trying to buy salvation through what you can do. And Jesus says that's impossible. You can't do that. It would be easier for you to take a cow and somehow squish it through the needle in your home than you can to buy salvation like that, to earn it with your good works. So he says, with man, this is impossible. But here's the gospel. Everything's about the gospel. The good news of Jesus is that it is impossible for you and me to do this. But with God, all things are possible. Nothing is impossible with God. So he says this second part. With God, all things, including salvation, heaven, eternal life, are possible. That's 26, the last part of 26. And so when the man answered that he had kept the observable laws, the neighbor laws, Jesus' follow-up statement was verse 21. If that's great, if you want to be perfect, if you want eternal life, then go sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and you're going to have treasure in heaven, then come follow me. So Jesus gives him two commands. Sell everything, come follow me. Sell everything, come follow me. Salvation, heaven, eternal life, these are all synonymous in the text, whether it's kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, being saved, eternal life, they're all synonymous. But all of those, salvation, heaven, eternal life, they are not transactional. It's transformational. That's what Jesus is getting at. This is not a transaction that we make with God, but it's a transformation that is brought on by God. He tells us that way back in Ezekiel 36, verses 26 to 27. Ezekiel prophesies. He says, I will give you, God is speaking through him, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to follow my statutes and carefully observe my ordinances. You see, the reason that you and I cannot save ourselves, that you and I cannot earn eternal life, you and I can't get into heaven on our own, is because our hearts are made of stone. They are dead. And dead hearts are only good at one thing, being dead. But through faith in Christ, God makes our dead hearts alive and beating for him. Now, I don't have a lot of time to explain this, but let me explain one thing that some of you may be tracking. Well, wait a minute. What about faith? That's a work, so that's something I do to get something in return. No. In Scripture, faith is trusting. It's not actually doing something. There is a very clear delineation between works and faith. Faith is not based on what I can do, but I am trusting what Jesus did. He did it, and that's enough for me. That's different. So faith is not a work. So when we talk about that with God all things are possible, and that in Christ we can be given these hearts of flesh now, that God can put his spirit in us, that is not something that I can do. What I'm doing is I'm trusting that Jesus has done it, and God can do it through Jesus. That when Jesus went to the cross, for every single person in here, including me and online, Jesus took my sin and your sin, and he was nailed to that cross because of our sin, and the wrath of God was poured out on him in judgment for our sin. And if I don't want judgment of my own sin, then I trust in what Jesus has done. And when he said it is finished, there's nothing else that has to be done or said. Jesus accomplished it. God accepted it because 3 days later, he gave him life again. And Jesus is alive today to give you and me that kind of life, that kind of fleshly heart that's alive and is beating with him and for him. What is impossible with man is possible with God. Henry Blackaby, in his book, Experiencing God, this is one of the things that he says. There's lots of quotable things in there, but this is one of the things that he says. He says, knowing about God will leave you dissatisfied. Knowing about God will leave you dissatisfied. Knowing God will bring ultimate satisfaction. Now, that's not anything great and grand. Most of us probably could have come up with that on our own. But it's true. It's that some of you have come to church for a long time, and yet you leave the same way, dissatisfied in your soul, because you've only known about God. You come, you're like a sponge, you soak up what the preacher says, what Sunday school teaches you, and all of that, but it has not led to transforming you from the inside out. If you are really honest with yourself, you are still the same person right now as you were 30 years ago, because you started that relationship with a transaction and not a transformation. And today is the day God is calling you to get that right. I'm glad we don't have a ton of guests this morning. I really am. Because this is a sermon, a message from God to me and you for right now. Because the hard saying, we're going to get to some other hard sayings. This hard saying is the hardest. Not because it's hard to understand, it's hard to apply. Are you saying Jesus wants me to sell everything? Yes, if that everything is what's keeping you from following him. Are you saying that Jesus wants me to leave that unhealthy relationship? If you are not in a married relationship and that relationship is unhealthy and keeping you from following Jesus, yes, Jesus says, don't let anything stand in the way from following me. Are you saying that I really need to come up front and I really need to do this in front of all these people who think I'm saved, but I know that if I died right now, I would not go to heaven? Yes, if that is what's keeping you from Jesus, then yes, you do. What is keeping you from Jesus right now? Don't rely on how much money you've given this church, because once you're gone, God's just going to use other people to fund his mission work here. Don't rely on how good you've been. Our good is like filthy rags in front of a holy God. Don't rely on some prayer that you prayed, that I prayed this prayer, I know I'm saved, but there's been no transformation in your life. We're going to sing a very simple song in just a second. And as we sing, I want you to respond. God wants you to respond. I've given one very clear call to salvation. For you, church member, if you're like this rich young ruler, that everybody else would say, yeah, he's saved. But you know, without a shadow of a doubt, you're not. When we start singing, you need to come get that straight today. For those of you who are lost and you have never been in church maybe, or maybe you've been in and out, Jesus is extending the same call to you as he did to that young man 2,000 years ago. If you want life, real life, then don't let anything stand in the way of trusting in Christ. Follow him. He is the way to life because he is life. If there's somebody in here that you know you're saved, but yet there's no passion for Jesus, there's no drive to tell people about him, to grow in him, you're just totally okay with the status quo, you need to get that settled today. What's standing in the way of you following Jesus, completely selling out for Jesus? So Abby, y'all come on up. We're going to sing two response songs, but the first one, I want you, this is the time that we're responding. This is the time that we're doing what God has called us to do. This is the time that we're saying, look, Jesus, it's you or nothing. I only want you, Jesus. I only want you. So would you please stand with me? Let me pray, and then we're going to sing and respond. And we've built time today. God has done this. Don't worry about the clock. We got plenty of time for God to respond. We want to see His Spirit move in our hearts this morning. Let me pray. Father, we love You. We ask that You would continue to show Yourself merciful and gracious and powerful in our midst. Father, if there's things in us, Lord, that are keeping us from being completely sold out for Jesus, from following Him with everything that we have, Lord, if there are things in us that we have viewed salvation as transactional and not transformational, Lord, we pray that you would just bring us to Yourself, to a spot of humility, God. That You would save those who need to be saved. That You would restore the salvation or the passion for those who need that, Lord. God, whatever You want to do, we pray that You would do it for Your glory, for Your honor, for the praise of Christ Jesus in our midst this morning. Lord, have Your way. We ask that You would do this in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. If God has been speaking to you this morning, don't delay. As soon as we start singing, you come forward, and let's continue to worship God by the way in which we respond. Closely as you have. You've allowed all these other things to take that spot, that top spot that only belongs to Him. And it may have gone on for year after year after year. Today is the day that you make a new, fresh commitment to the Lord to follow Him above all else. If that's you, come down. Let's rejoice about that. Let's talk about that. Let me pray for you about that. Or if you need prayer, look, we just saw God do a miracle. We stood here last week and prayed that God would do a miracle, that he would show himself as the God of the impossible. And you know what? He did. Rebecca's talking. She's hopefully going to be out of the ICU soon. If you don't know what I'm talking about, no worries. It's just that God did the impossible. And if you need that today, you need God to show up in your life to do that. Whatever that work is today, I'm going to ask you, would you come forward and let's pray about that? Would you allow us to pray for that? And if I get swamped with people, it's okay. There's enough people around here that would come forward and help pray and help counsel and all of that. But if God is doing something in your life, don't say no. Come forward and let's talk about it. Let's praise God for it. So we're going to sing one more verse to this, and then you respond. Pray with you or anything like that, please come get me. But we just want to continue to point one another to the Lord Jesus and who he is and what he's done. Let's continue to respond.
What'd you say?
When I fear my faith will fail,
just a few minutes, please. Thank you. I want to introduce to you Courtney McDonald. Courtney, go ahead and come on up here. Courtney is coming. yeah, maybe you come stand with her. There you go. Libby invited Courtney a little bit ago, and I've had the wonderful pleasure to speak with Courtney about a month ago, and just what God's doing in her life and how God brought her here, and what, I mean, God's just good. And to continue to bring people here to work in us and through us. And so this morning, she's coming to let you know that she is recommitting her life to putting Christ first and following Him only. And so we're going to rejoice first with that. Can we give God a praise for that? And she is wanting to come to unite with our church by a statement of faith, of which I've heard her testimony and how God has worked in her, and how hopefully we're going to be able to disciple her in the days and months and weeks ahead. And so if you would rejoice what God's doing bringing her here, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. You guys just hang out up here for a second. Look, let's all stand. Thank you for being here this morning. If you are a first-time guest, I have a special gift for you. There's a little white tent outside. I would love the opportunity to meet you in person. So as soon as we are dismissed, I'm going to head out there. And if you brought somebody, please bring them by. I'd love to meet them and just thank them for coming. And when I go that way, you guys come this way and love on Courtney, okay? Let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing as we leave. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for what you have done and are doing and have promised that you are going to continue to do. Lord, use us out there as much as you did in here. Lord, we want to be in your presence there as much as we are here. Father, I pray that Jesus would become greater in our life, that his purpose becomes our purpose. Lord, his passions become our passions. Father, would you use us in the power of your Spirit to reach people, to minister to people, to love on people, to pray for people this week that need Jesus. Lord, use us in the lives of people for your great name and glory. And we ask that you would be honored through what we do this week. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.